Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome. So I have to announce that our one-act play today is canceled. No, it's called Canceled. That's the title. Look at your program. See a little joke there? See where I'm going there? I know. It's bad. Anyways, we're very excited to have you all here today. I've had the pleasure of working with a truly remarkable group of students, one of the best group of students I've had in my many years teaching dramatic arts at Sheehan High School. And they were so talented that we've actually selected a more challenging play than we've done in the past. This one really requires a lot of skill on the part of the actors. It's an ensemble production where they're pretty much on stage the whole time. They have to really work closely together on fast-paced dialogue and action and dual roles, innuendos, subtext, so it takes a lot of work, and they've done such a great job of rising to meet the challenges with commitment and with such talent, and I'm so proud of what they've done to get to where we are today. Just a reminder, as I always do, this is live theater, so please be respectful of your classmates. It takes a lot of courage to perform live on stage without a safety net, so just be supportive and encouraging throughout. One addition to the program, a new student joined us 2 weeks ago. Her name is Leah Vasquez, and she will be playing the part of one of the policemen. So without further ado, I proudly present to you our one-act play, Canceled.
Does anyone know why we're here? Walter wouldn't tell me. He just said be here half hour early for the show, and that's damn peculiar if you ask me.
Yeah, I bet it has something to do with the script. I didn't get one this week. Did anyone else?
No.
Nothing.
Honestly, is it too much to ask for to get a script in enough time to memorize the bloody thing? It's getting harder for me to see every day, and reading these shows, cold, live on the air, with no rehearsal time, is starting to wear me out.
It's unprofessional is what it is. You know, Edelman's a very good writer and all, but it's called a deadline for a reason.
Yeah, well, I like it when I don't have to rehearse. It gives me more time for other things.
Like what, medical school?
Oh, finally, what's kept you, Walter?
Oh, sorry I'm late, everybody. I'm glad you all could make it on such short notice.
What's this all about, Tony?
Well, it seems that our radio show, Life in Barker's Corners, has been canceled.
What happened?
Well, it seems we're losing our sponsors. They say they're losing money, and just about all of them have left.
Well, I thought all the sponsors were pleased with the show. I got a lovely letter just last week from the president of Stay Pure Water Softening Tablets. Of course, I might have been for something other than my work on the show.
Surely not old Gray Mare cigarettes, Walter. I have a lifetime contract with them. They give me my cigarettes for free, you know. 3 packs a day. Oh. And I plan on advertising with them for another 50 years. I relish their deep, rich flavor.
Pipe down, will ya? You're not on the air yet, you ham.
Yes, all of them. Old Gray Mare, Vivacious Face Cream, even Chubby Bubbles pork-flavored soda pop. And we're the only show they sponsor. I don't quite understand it myself, but that's the word from Jay Allen, so that's that.
So when is our last show?
Last week.
We're already off the air? This is an outrage, Walter.
What's going on in our place?
Ted Barkley Symphonette Hour. On recording.
Recording? Oh, what an insult.
We do it live.
Wait, what about the fans? They'll be left hanging. Old man Bates was on his deathbed.
What about Jennifer's baby? Is Parker the father or the drifter?
What about my mink?
Your what?
I just started buying a mink on time. If I'm out of a job, I'm not going to be able to make the payments for it.
Couldn't you just return the mink?
Are you kidding? I ain't even worn it yet.
Walter, isn't there anything you could do? Plead with Jay Allen. Get him to give us another week or two.
I'm sorry, folks. It's over.
Well, I guess that's it. What's to become of us?
You'll have to move on, I suppose. You know, no job lasts forever. Unfortunately, there are no open roles right now. Every other show seems to be doing well, I'm afraid.
Well, what about you?
Oh, I've got another job.
Doing what, pray tell?
Producing another show.
Here?
Yes.
Oh my god.
Oh my god. This is, I can't believe
you. Go easy, everybody. J. Allen Hunsicker offered me another job. What was I supposed to do, turn him down? Yeah. You turned down J. Allen Hunsicker, and you can just hang it in this town.
Well, you've certainly got things ironed out then, haven't you? It's very well for the rest of you to go from job to job, but I'm an old man. I've been on the show for 10 years. What kind of work am I supposed to find at my age?
There are lots of opportunities out there for you, Jasper.
Such as?
Well, Christmas is right around the corner. You'd be a perfect Santa at Macy's or Gimbel's. Or maybe you could just sell pencils or something.
You bastard.
If there were any justice in this world, Walter, you'd be the one selling pencils on the sidewalk and J.L. competing for space right next to you. Of all the gall, I've never heard such a callous attitude in my life.
Here.
I agree. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right. You've all made your position perfectly clear, and so have I. My hands are tied. It's been a genuine pleasure working with all of you, and I wish you all the best of luck.
Well, that's it, I suppose.
And Davis wasn't even here to know about it.
We'll catch up with him later.
Well, does anyone have any plans?
How could we possibly have plans? We just got fired.
Well, I mean, we've got the evening to kill. Does anyone want to take in a movie?
Don't you understand? We don't have two nickels to rub together, you sap. I'll probably have to move into a Hooverville someplace.
Oh. Don't pay any attention to George. He's independently wealthy. He has no idea what it's like to have to watch every penny.
Hey, now, that's not fair. I've been on this show for 3 years. I put a lot of sweat into it.
Put a lot of cheese in it, you mean?
What's that supposed to mean?
Means you couldn't deliver a convincing line if your life depended on it. And lucky for you now, it never will.
Let me at him.
Hey, let's all settle down. Tempers are high right now. What do you say we all go take in a dinner and then a late movie? It'll all be on me.
You'll have to do that without me. I'm going home to sleep this off.
Count me out too, Fred. It's very kind of you, but I just don't feel like making merry right now. I have to go decide if I want to eat or pay the rent with my last paycheck.
Well, I'll go. I'm just dying to see that new Cary Grant picture at the Avalon. I should go home and get my mink first. It might be the only time you get to wear it before it's repossessed.
Oh, screw your mink.
Hey, is there any way for a lady to talk?
How would you know?
Well, I never. Come on, let's get out of here. Drink the Ramones before we leave.
Hi, everyone. What did I miss?
God, Davis. We'll explain it to you downstairs. Come on.
Let's go. Now everyone just stay quiet and nobody's gonna get hurt.
What is it you want?
You don't remember me, big boy? Aw, I'm hurt. I remember you awful well.
You're Monty Nivoli from Monty's Green Grocer.
There, I thought this would jog your memory.
Where have I heard that name before? They're a new sponsor. This was supposed to start with commercials on tonight's show.
Yeah, the dame's right. Only I got word that your little show got the axe. Which means my commercials ain't gonna be running, and that ain't exactly good for business.
Oh, well, you should just take that up with J. Allen Hunsicker. He handles all the business matters.
Yeah, well, Hunsicker ain't my problem, bub. You are. You know it, and I know it. I put some money into this show. A lot of money. Too much money, if you ask me. And you were in charge of that money.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Come on, don't play dumb with me. I ain't got the time. I want my money back, and I want it back now. And I could take it in cash or some other way.
What are you talking about, Walter? What's all this money?
Now, let's not be hasty, Mr. Nivoli. I'm sure we can work something out.
Yeah, like what?
Well...
Come on, pal. Time's wasted.
We could go ahead with tonight's show.
Are you crazy, Walter? We don't even have a script.
Screw the script. I'm not going to perform my last show, probably for free, just to get this... whale off the hook with a two-bit hood.
Not so fast. Nobody's going anywhere until I get paid back. One way or the other. Come to think of it, that idea may not be so bad after all.
What?
Yeah, I like your show. It's dirty. So I picked it to advertise my little, operation. I want to hear what's going to happen to Jennifer and that bum from Detroit anyways. Yeah, that's it. You guys go ahead with tonight's show, or the commercials, and we'll be square.
Now listen here, you hoodlum!
What are you doing?
This is an outrage. We will not be pushed around. And you, what have you got to say for yourself? This is all your fault!
Oh, can't you just leave me alone? I took the money, all right? I spent it already. I can't pay it back. This is the only way out. You don't want to see me get killed, do you?
A little bit.
Yeah, kind of.
Aw, dry up, you fat sissy. Nobody's getting shot here tonight. That is, as long as everyone does the show.
Look here, Mr. Ravioli. It's Navoli. Oh, Navoli.
Call me Monty.
Monty, can we have a little time to prepare? You see, we haven't gotten the script yet for tonight's show. It's in the writer's office down the hall, and we can't very well do a show without a script,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, that's pretty important.
All right, it's you and me, baby, cries a lot. And the rest of you, don't try to be heroes. I'm right down the hall, and you know, something could happen.
Oh, we won't, Mr. Navoli. Monty! Thank God that's over. Now let's get the hell out of here. Are you crazy? They'll be back any second, unless you're in a rush to get your head blown off.
If we're quick, we can make it to the elevator in a few seconds. We'll be out the door, and it's over.
Yeah, I'm with Constance, but we can't just stand here talking about it all day.
Well, you can count me out. I've come too far to take a bullet at my age.
Wait, everyone, wait. We can't just leave. Why not?
Because if we leave and don't do the show, that Navoli character will kill Monty.
Oh, let him.
We'll kill Walter.
Oh, let him.
Oh, come on. The man might have done something pretty crummy, I'll admit. I'm not sure what. But it doesn't mean we want to see Walter dead. Do we?
Oh, I guess you're right.
Well, that was quick. Don't tell me Edelman didn't have a script.
No, he had it.
Well, let's stop then. It's only a few minutes until we are. We can at least get the first few pages to look over.
Monty, would you mind if I had a word in private with the actors for a moment, please? To help them get ready for the show, you know. Give them a little pep talk, a warm-up.
All right. No funny business.
Oh, no, of course not.
What is it, Walter? What's wrong? Is there something wrong with the script?
Not exactly. The script as such is fine.
Could you just get to the point, Slav?
Well, you see, Edelman got the word about the cancellation a couple of days ago. Andy Golden is leaving the fabulous Mr. Smoot, and Edelman's taking his spot. And he only had 5 pages of this week's script finish.
5 pages? Walter, we've got 40 minutes to fill. Edelman's scripts usually work out to a minute a page. What are we supposed to do for the other 35?
I don't know. Improvise?
I don't believe this. I wasn't hired to make stuff up. That's for someone else to do.
Yes.
Look, everyone, what choice do we have?
Yes, listen to Dennis. There is no other way out of this.
Well, couldn't we just do an old script?
Of course not. You heard Navoli. He loves our show. He'd know that he heard the script before.
Well, we better figure something out. We got 5 minutes till we're on the air.
Well, I for one look forward to it. I think it might be a challenge.
Yeah, what better way for the show to go out than an ending we all create ourselves?
Well, it'll be a bit like my old vaudeville days. Bitchley and Hughes, Black and Blues.
Thanks for the trip down memory lane, Pop. We just get started.
Wait.
What?
Where's Roger?
Oh, I completely forgot. Roger left for the gay mortician. They need a second sound effects man now that the series takes place in a munitions factory.
Well, how are we supposed to do a show without sound effects?
Well, if we need the sound of nails on a chalkboard, dear, you can do that one.
Now listen, you!
Ladies, please. Walter can do sound effects, can't you, Walter?
Of course. Sounds like fun.
Oh, my God.
No pun intended.
Well, let's give it all we've got.
So, anybody want a little bottle of bravery?
What? Why do you have that? Why do you have that?
You're going to go on the air.
What is wrong with you? Oh, my goodness. Where's mine? Thank you.
Life in Barker's Corner, starring Fred Bennett, Constant Figgs, and George Mint. Brought to you tonight by Monty's Green Grocer. Monty's Green Grocer, where you get what you want, or else. When we left you last week, Parker Bates, heir to the Bates Feed Supply Empire, was at bedside of his father, Parker Bates Sr., who is dying of blood hypovolemia. And what of Parker's beloved Jennifer? She is in heavy with child. Quite the scandal in this little burg. And even more scandalous is her affair with Jonesy, the drifter from Detroit. He has an eye on Emily Rudyard, wife of the town physician, Dr. Rupert Rudyard. Sit back, relax, and join us as we return once again to the little town of Barker's Corner, where life is simpler, but the people are just as complex as you and me.
Sorry. Oh, Papa, I can't bear to see you like this. There's so much more I need to learn from you about feed supply. So many questions left to ask you.
People come in, ask for feed, you give them feed. It's not that hard.
Yes, but you made it so much more than that, Papa. You made it noble.
There's no nobility in hay and hog slop. Remember that. You know everything you need to know to keep the Bates feed supply running. There's only one thing that could cause it to fail.
And what's that, Papa?
You don't have a son to carry on the family name.
That's the doorbell, Papa. It'll be Jennifer. She has some wonderful news for you.
Has she discovered a cure for blood hypovolemia?
No, I'll let her tell you herself, Papa. Oh, Jennifer, darling.
Parker, my beloved.
That darn door is stuck again.
Stop it all. Have you told your father our news?
No, I want you to tell him. Make his final hours on this earth full of hope that his legacy will live on. Another little Bates to carry on his legacy.
Hello, my dear. You're looking well.
Thank you, Mr. Bates. So are you.
That's very kind of you, dear. But I have blood hypovolemia, and I'm not long for this world.
Hurry, darling, before he dies.
Mr. Bates, your son and I are going to have a baby.
What?
In about a week.
What? But you're not married.
No, Papa, we're not married.
You can't bring a bastard into this world, Parker. It'll ruin the family's business, and the family's reputation in Barker's Corner will be ruined.
Papa, if it'll make you happy, I promise I'll marry Jennifer right here and now. What do you say, darling?
Of course, my love. I want to spend the rest of my life with you.
Really?
Yes. Drink some water, Papa. It's big news. Jennifer, you've made me the happiest man in Barker's Corners. You've made me the happiest man in the world.
Oh, me. Yes, darling, me too.
Now I can die a happy man, another heir to carry on the family name and the family business. The blood hypovolemia can take me now. I'm ready.
Oh, Parker, is he?
Yes, darling. He's dead.
Well, perhaps it's for the best.
You bet it is.
Oh, Jonesy!
Hi there, gorgeous.
And now you wait just a minute, you drifter. Jennifer is my fiancée. You can't just waltz into my father's house like you own the place and take her from me without a fight.
You want to bet on that fancy boy?
Oh, Jonesy, don't hurt him.
Stay out of this, dollface. Go wait in the living room. It might get messy in here. Here's a kiss for good luck.
Now, look here, you drifter. This has gone far enough.
Oh, my God, they're getting into it. I
think it's time to teach you a lesson. You're the strong silent type, huh? Well, take this.
You'll be sorry you did that, Bates.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Where was the sound?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah? Oh! Jennifer's mine, you bum. You'll never have her. We're gonna be married, and what's more, she's having my baby. What do you think about that?
What makes you so sure it's your kid?
What do you mean?
How blind can you be, buddy? She's the town tramp. She's been with every man in Barker's Corners.
I will not stand here in the presence of my dead father and allow you to besmirch the reputation of his daughter-in-law-to-be.
Stop it, you two!
Emily, what are you doing here?
I came as soon as I heard your father died.
Yeah, he just died a few seconds ago.
Now, what's this all about? I found Jennifer with tears all over her eyes.
Emily,
what has made you two so mad at each other? I want to know what has come between you, Parker Bates, the heir to the Bates food supply business, and
Jonesy, the gruff but lovable drifter, and...
We'll return to Life in Barker's Corner in a moment. First, a word from our sponsor, Monty's Green Grocer, is a...
What'd you do that for, you drunk idiot?
Because I didn't have a dirty sock to shove in your mouth.
Well, I think this is going splendidly, everybody.
Oh, you do ya? Well, now we gotta jump into it for real. We're out of script.
Well, Monty likes it. Don't you, Monty?
Eh. Oh, just you wait, Monty. I studied improvisation at Harvard. You're in for a real treat.
You studied at Harvard University?
No, Harvard Drive Actors Academy in Burbank. It's a small school, but with a rich history.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Katherine Hepburn herself actually came in once to use the facilities.
Yeah, you really want to do this, don't you?
Yes, I do. I can't wait to begin.
Okay, well, how about this? When we come back, we'll have your character, Dr. Rudyard, come into the scene. You could start, and we'll all play off whatever you do.
Splendid idea, Fred. It'll put everyone else at ease to have a real professional take the lead for a bit.
Well, I don't know about professional, but I'm pretty good.
Well, we better start heading over there.
Oh dear, what about Jennifer?
Well, obviously, Betty's gonna have to play part. Wait, no, I'm getting paid as it is. I ain't gonna play two parts.
Please, Jennifer is essential to the story. I think Constance would want you to play the part.
Really?
Yeah, she would.
Oh, okay. I'll do it. All right, I guess I'll do it.
Yes, that's Monty's Green Grocer, where if you ask for it, you're gonna get it. 709 North LaLiberte Avenue in Hollywood. And now back to Life in Barker's Corner. We left, Emily at Rudyard has just interrupted fistcuffs between her secret lover, the drifter Jonesy, and Parker Bates, the heir to the Bates feed supply fortune, whose father just died of blood corpophilia. And now, back to our story.
Hey, say something.
Well, Emily, I suppose you've made your choice.
Well, yes, George, I have.
It's Jonesy.
But I picked my husband.
Well, you've had your chance, baby. It's time for this gruff but lovable drifter to be moving on.
Don't go, Jonesy!
I've got to, Emily.
No, I'm Jennifer now.
Really?
Yeah.
Jennifer.
Yes, Parker, I'm afraid it's true. I can't deny my feelings for Jonesy any longer.
Well, that ship has sailed, baby. It's time for this gruff but lovable drifter to be moving on. It's not my type to stay in one place for too long. No ties, no responsibilities. I like to think of it the life my dear mama would have had if she hadn't married that band leader from Ojai and gotten herself knocked up. Now I think I'm just gonna get on my motorcycle and head out of town. Don't know if I'll ever be back this way again.
Get the motorcycle sounds.
Looks like that starter's sticking again.
That's not a motorcycle.
Oh, huh? Jonesy, I didn't know you were with the police.
Yes, the state police. My name is, Moishe Jones. I came to find out who gave old man Bates the injection of blood to hygelichesia.
Injection? Are you saying my father was murdered?
Yes, that's exactly what I'm saying.
Why couldn't you tell me, George? I fell for you. I almost left my husband for you.
Because each of you was a suspect.
Why would you suspect us?
Because, Parker was supposed to inherit the feed supply, but we cleared him because he said that needles make him faint. And for a while, we thought it was Jennifer, but she was having Parker's baby, and
you thought that my father wouldn't let me marry her.
Good. I mean, yes, that was a theory.
But I thought the baby was yours, Jonesy!
It can't be Jennifer. You see, you can't get pregnant from a tire swing.
What does that even mean?
I don't know. But I just said that so I could stay in the case for a little while longer.
What motive would my husband and I have for injecting the old man with the blood globophorphia?
He was on to you.
On to us?
Yes, he thought that you and Dr. Rudyard were, Nazi spies.
Nazi spies?
I have to go to the lavatory.
Papa, you're alive.
What? No, you fool. What are you on about?
You have to go to the lavatory, Papa?
Yes!
Oh, well, what better sign of life than urination?
What are you...
I think he's a little confused, Parker, what with just having died and all, you know?
Of course, yeah. Yes.
Is Parker Bates Sr. alive or dead? Is all this just a side effect of the hallucinatory drugs given to them by Dr. and Mrs. Rudyard? And just where is Dr. Rudyard? Find out after these words from Monty's greengrocer.
What am I gonna do?
What the hell are you doing? First you turn it into some murder mystery and then some half-baked Nazi spy story?
Hey, get off my back. I don't see you doing much to the proceedings. I'm doing it all myself.
Hey, hold it, Harshaw. I'm doing two parts. I'm doing a hell of a lot my own self.
And you're doing fine, Betty.
Oh, really?
No.
Oh.
Look, are you going to let me go to the lavatory or not?
Go, but make it fast.
Good. One day, young man, you'll be as old as I am and you'll know how impossible speed is in the lavatory.
Just go before I make you stay here and go in a trash can.
Oh.
This is a nightmare. It's like riding a blind horse through a burning building.
Yeah, with about as much chance of getting out alive if we don't make this work.
Hey, what about him? Why ain't he saying anything?
What?
What the hell? Why'd you freeze up? I thought you said you were good at improvising.
I don't know. I just saw the on-air sign out of the corner of my eye and realized we were being broadcasted into 5 million homes in the greater Los Angeles area, and flashed back onto an Edison cylinder I recorded for my grandmother as an adolescent, and it was so bad that they had to put her into a home.
Oh my gosh, I'm so sorry.
Yeah, I guess I can improv where I can use my face and body, but not where it's just my voice. I'm just too self-conscious.
Wait. Is that Constance's flask in your pocket?
Yeah, I wrestled it from her hands. Little good it did.
Well, there's your answer.
Who, me? No, I don't drink.
Why not? Is it your stomach?
No. Suffice to say, I tend to do something rather embarrassing.
Well, whatever it is, it can't be worth holding up the show for. Besides, we're all friends here.
Come on, Dennis. Just drink up. It'll do you good for the next segment.
Come on. What was that?
What the hell was that? Keep going.
Bottoms up.
There we go.
There you go. Yeah. Just in time, too.
Yes, that's Monty's Green Grocer. Bring us a competitor's low price and we'll beat them. 709 North LaLiberte Avenue in Hollywood. And now, back to life in Barker's Corner. We left, Parker Bates Sr. had just had a miraculously return to life.
No, he's not here anymore. He's not here anymore.
Well, I'm sorry, Parker, but it seems that your father has died.
He was bound to die again. It's okay.
You'll never prove anything, Detective Jones!
That's right, Jones. You'll never prove we're with the Russians.
No, we're with the Nazis, dear.
Are we?
Yeah. Detective! I've known Emily Rudyard since we were in grade school together, and although I am far older than her, I can tell you that there's one thing she ain't, isn't, and that's a Nazi.
I don't see what's so funny, Dr. Rudyard.
What did I miss?
Mother! Mother! How nice of you to come!
Mother! Ah, get off me, you pal! I'm gonna strangle you with your overseer, you just fell with a slut!
Emily and her mother have never gotten along for days.
Hey. Oh, my God. Oh, my God!
That's so much better.
Going on. I'm back!
We at KWEE apologize for the technical difficulty. We will resume to Life in Barker's Corner in just a moment.
All right, what the hell is going on?
What are you talking about? I thought everything was going swimmingly.
You better start doing this thing right, or I'm gonna start getting my money back the old-fashioned way. You! Hey, you! Put your pants back on!
There you go.
You two alley cats split up. I don't want you anywhere near each other for the rest of the show. Got it?
Fine.
Pull up your pants.
We don't have time to put on a pot of coffee or I'd have the two drunks drowning in it.
Monty!
Thank you.
crazy. Joey, take her back to the car.
What? I don't want to go back to the car.
You only got two more segments till this whole mess is over. You do it right, you do it professional, you make Monty's green grocer shine, and the lead pills stay in the Roscoe, right?
Yeah. I have a question.
What?
Before we went off the air, the listeners, they heard your gun go off. How are we supposed to address that?
Right. We gotta bump somebody off. Let's make it the old man. I'm getting tired of him coming and going like that.
Okay, suits me fine. I need to sit down.
Hit it, mouth.
We now return to you to life in Barker's Corner. When we last left, a miraculous, mysterious shot has rung out in the home of Parker Bates Sr., who has been resurrected after dying of blood gonorrhea.
My father, he's been shot.
But who would do such a thing?
It was I, Dr. Rupert Rudyard.
But why, darling?
He was going to rat us out, my love. Not literally.
Well, it's curtains for you, Rudyard. I'm Detective Moisey Jones of the California State Police Department, and you're going away for treason and murder.
Not so fast, Coppa. Nobody's going no place. I got the Roscoe, and you'll all do as I say.
Oh, Rudyard, I've never heard you speak this way before. You sound so masculine.
Get him out of here.
Really? It's just something I thought I'd try out. Yeah, we'll get used to it, Emily. We're on the lam, and from now on, I ain't gonna be a doctor no more.
Dennis, can I talk to you privately for a second?
But I gotta hold the gat on these swells.
Just stand out in the hall where you can keep an eye on them. It'll just take a moment, lover.
Yeah, all right.
What are we gonna do, Parker?
Well, we have to get the gun out of his hands.
I don't see how. Rudyard's looking right at us.
You've seen as many action movies as I have. They always find some way to pull the wool over a punk's eye.
Yes, yes. Like a distraction or something.
Yeah, but how are we gonna do that without getting shot?
Well, we have to try, Jonesy. Jennifer, if this is our last moment together, I need to ask you something.
Yes, Parker?
I need to ask you to do two last favors for my family. First, take care of our child, Parker Bates III, and give him a good life and tell him about his father.
Yes, Parker.
And second, you see that umbrella in the corner?
Yes.
That umbrella belonged to my father, but the stand that the umbrella is in belonged to Mike Portnoy, his best friend who died in the Great War. Mike's gone now, but you must remember that umbrella stand for our child. Mike's stand is very important. Mike's stand is very important.
That's a nice stand there, Parker.
Yes, it is, Jonesy. Look at the carving. It looks like vines or cords of some kind wrapped around the base. Oh. Well, I suppose there's no time like the present. Let's take this dastardly criminal out.
Sure thing, Parker.
What
now,
the?
Fred.
Walter, get a gun!
What?
Shot me, you goofy Jane.
Move a muscle, I'll shoot more than that.
Well done, everyone.
Betty.
Well done, indeed.
Betty, go call the police.
Well, Mr. Monty Nivoli, looks like you're not stuck without your gun, are you?
Clam up, Walt. You had it coming.
That was quick thinking on your part, Fred.
Thanks. You did pretty well yourself.
And you were nothing short of spectacular.
Oh, I was an army brat. Pick things up.
Well, let a fellow buy you a drink when this is over. Maybe give him a few pointers.
I thought you'd never ask.
Expert work, everyone.
Yeah, too bad that wasn't being filmed for the big screen. Would have come off looking like a couple of heroes.
Well, who knows? We're still out of a job. Maybe movies are the way to go for us.
You pansy boys wouldn't last 5 minutes in a real fight.
Can it?
What if I don't? I ain't seen a dame yet that can shoot.
Try me.
Yeah, you go right ahead. You ain't got the gumption.
I do, Monty.
Oh, my gosh.
Well done, old man.
Well, I've had some training, too.
Night.
They didn't call us Fitchley and Hughes black and blues for nothing.
I called the cops!
Oh, what a big girl you are!
They'll be here soon, and Kenny is right behind me.
Kenny? Wonder what he wants.
everybody. Have you heard the good news?
No, we've been a little, preoccupied. Kenny?
What's all the rhubarb?
Well, Mr. Hansaker told me to come up here right away. He says that he's been getting telegrams and phone calls ever since the show started.
But that was just a few minutes of... Oh, well, let's just say that wasn't our best work.
Well, whatever it is working. Over 100 calls and telegrams in 20 minutes, including everyone and sponsors. And Mr. Hansaker says the show is back on air!
Well, gang, it seems like our Mr. Nivoli character is the only one who didn't care for our performance tonight.
Hey, but if we're going back on the air, what are we going to do about the director, the producer?
And sound effects man.
Yeah, and a writer.
Writer?
What do we need with a writer? We're the best thing to have on this show since it went on the air. Oh, God. Oh.
Good evening, all. I'm Sergeant Donovan from the Los Angeles Police Department Organized Crime Division. I hear there's someone I need to pick up.
Oh, yes, sir. He's right there.
Why, that's Monty Naboli. We've been looking for him since 1938.
Sergeant, didn't our dear, simple-minded Betty tell you who it was you were picking up?
Betty? Who's Betty?
Me, that's who. I was the one who called the police.
Well, it's not my place to contradict a lady, ma'am.
Oh, don't worry. You won't be.
But I got a call from J. Allen Hunsicker.
J. Allen? How did he know that Naboli was here?
He didn't call about Naboli. He called about one Walter St. Paul.
Walter?
Oh, dear, oh, dear, oh, dear.
Don't worry, Walter. We'll bring you a cake and violet.
Yeah, and arsenic.
Boys, put the bracelets on these two. In this Naboli character.
Oh, believe us, Sergeant. You're showing your gratitude by taking out that other rubber.
How the mighty have fallen. Hey, big boy?
So help me, Naboli, if I weren't wearing these cuffs.
You'd what, pork pie?
Come on, boys.
I've been on the radio for 12 years, and I've never had a night like this.
Yeah, it really makes you think, don't it?
Constance.
Who, me?
Come on, drop the level, little drifter. Go get that drink. Hey.
Oh! It's all going to be on me. Don't worry, I'll make sure you keep your pants on.
Thank you, Fred.
This is the exit, people.
It rains, panties from heaven.
Shooby dooby.
Don't you know each cloud contains panties from heaven?
Shooby dooby.
You'll find your fortune falling all over town. Be sure that your umbrella is up, upside down. And trading for a package of sunshine and ravioli.
Macaroni.
If you want the thing you love, you must have a pizza only, baby. When you hear thunder, don't run under a tree. It'll be pennies from heaven for you and me. Now come over here, boy, Sam. And every time it rains, it rains. And don't you know it's crocodile? Every time it rains, it rains. And don't you know it's crocodile? You'll find your fortune falling all over town, all over town, all over town. Make sure that your umbrella is upside down and really live up. Oh, how about the hoes are right? Eagle, I'm a hungry. Zumba, loo, the super loo. Oh, bottle of boys are right.